Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.
Bibles, book of Mark, chapter number 10 is where I'm going to be tonight. Not going to be too long. I just want to obey the Lord, and I appreciate the opportunity to stand and preach. And I don't take it lightly. It's you're standing between us, people in eternity. A preacher talks about the things that will change your life in a year will be either the books you read, the people you'll meet, and the message you'll hear preached. And, saying tonight, it can change your life. The Lord could do a work in your heart. I don't know what you need, but I know the Lord, and I know He knows what we need. And so I just trust the Lord. And a lot of times you say, well, the pastor's not here, so we'll just we'll ease on, get me a little nap, amen. But I tell you, I just encourage you tonight to maybe try to get in the message, and we'll pray for our preacher here in just a moment. And I want you to beg God to help our preacher tonight. Traveling and all that can wear on your body, and you get up to preach, you give it all you got. And I tell you, we need to pray for him that the devil wouldn't discourage him, put a hedge of protection about him with his travels as he stands to preach in the power of God. I tell you, we got a good pastor around here. And I know we got some first-time attenders here tonight, and I hate that they're not hearing our pastor tonight, but it'll be good. Amen. So let's do this. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and let's pray for our preacher. Lord, we do love you. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your grace, Lord, on our lives. Lord, bringing us here to church tonight. And Lord, I pray, Lord, for our pastor, Lord. Lord, I pray you bless Preacher Hopkins, Lord, where he's at right now, Lord, as he stands to preach. Lord, I just pray, God, you put a hedge of protection about him, Lord, and you would, Lord, fill him with the Holy Ghost, Lord. Let him preach, Lord, Lord, what you've laid on his heart, Lord. And may the people he's preaching to, Lord, be receptive to the Word of God. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that we have a preacher, Lord, that travels and encourages, Lord, and is a sought-out man, God, for congregations all over the place, Lord. They all want him to come preach. Lord, that's a blessing to us, God, to know we got that kind of man of God. And Lord, I thank you for his family. I pray you bless his family tonight, Lord, as he's away. Lord, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. I heard a story, and kind of along the lines, I guess, of marriage and different things. Y'all probably heard that news story that was on the news a while back. It was about a 90-year-old, how many of y'all might have heard it? That 90-year-old woman getting married for the fourth time. Y'all hear about it? And man, it was like she's 90 years old. She's planning her wedding, and she's excited, and she's giddy, and she's all this and that. And so what happened was the news got a hold of it and said, man, a 90-year-old woman getting married for the fourth time. This is a story. And it wasn't like she had divorced and remarried. It was, every one of her husbands had passed away, and she had found another man. So they went and said, we got to do an interview. We got to interview this lady. And so he went to her, and they said, ma'am, he said, look, can we do an interview? And she said, sure. She said, sure you can. I'm busy with my wedding planning, but I'll pause for an interview. I'm 90 years old. And they said, ma'am, we just want to talk to you. Just tell us about your husband. She said, well, it's easy. She said, my first husband was a banker. He said, wow. And she said, when he died, I met a circus clown. And she said, I love that circus clown. And the Lord put us together. And he said, well, okay. And he said, and it was a good marriage. And he passed away. And then the third marriage, she married a preacher. And that preacher, buddy, she served the Lord with that preacher, and he passed away. And that fourth one she's getting ready to marry, he was a funeral director. And they just thought, my goodness, ma'am, what in the world? How did you pick these women or these men? How did you pick these men? I mean, all these different, occupations. Well, she said, that's easy. She said, I married the banker. She said, one for the money. She said, I married the circus clown, two for the show. She said, I married the preacher, three to get ready. And she said, I'm marrying the funeral director, four to go. So she had it all figured out, didn't she? Amen. So that's my attempt at a joke tonight. That's probably the only time you're going to laugh. So I hope you got it in. Amen. So one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready. Here we go. All right. So Mark chapter 10, verse number 17. The Bible says, "And when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. That thou knowest the commandments, do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and mother. And he answered and said unto him, master, all these have I observed from my youth? Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him and said unto him, one thing thou lackest. Now listen real close, church. It says, one thing thou lackest, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Come, take up the cross and follow me. And here's one of the saddest verses in your King James Bible. And he was sad at the saying, and he went away grieved, for he had great possessions. Jesus looked round about and saith unto his disciples, how hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? And the disciples were astonished at his words, but Jesus answereth again and saith unto them, children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. And they were astonished out of measure, saying among themselves, who then can be saved? And we'll read the next verse there, and we'll be done with the reading for tonight. It says, and Jesus looking upon them saith, with men it is impossible, but not with God. Amen. For God, all things are possible. I'm going to bring you a message tonight entitled, one thing thou lackest. One thing thou lackest. You see, I want to show you a few things about this man in the Bible. The Bible says, in other scriptures, calls him a rich young ruler. He was a man who seemed to have it all together. He was a man who seemed to have all his ducks in a row. He was a man who didn't have a lot of issues and problems maybe on the outside of his life. But let me tell you, he didn't have it all together on the inside. You say, well, what's the big deal? You know, what's the big deal? You can have it all together. You can have the nicest things. You can have it all the biggest house. You can have all these lists of things, the best job, everything you can think of. But if you don't have Jesus on the inside, then you've got nothing. And you say, well, you can be the richest man in the world, but you'll be the most poor man if you're lost tonight. And you say, what's this message to tonight? I believe this message tonight is to that one that is lost. And you say, well, it's Wednesday night. Probably everybody's saved. Probably everybody's, going to heaven. And I tell you, I'd like to believe that tonight. But I'll just be honest with you. I came to church as a church member lost. And it was a Wednesday night. And the Lord began to deal with my heart. And I got saved on a Wednesday night. And the preacher was preaching the gospel. And you say, well, if it's just to lost people tonight, then I'm saved. And I don't need to listen. Well, I'll tell you tonight. This message tonight will help you if you're saved and you've got a lost loved one. It'll help you if you're saved and you've got somebody at your workplace that's lost. And I believe we'd all raise our hand and we know somebody lost. Let's go ahead. Raise your hand if you know somebody who's lost. I tell you, the Lord is give them a space to get right with the Lord. And we got to understand that heaven is eternal. Heaven is real. Hey, we're going there if you're saved. But if you're lost, hell awaits that one that's lost. It's not a play game. It's not a joke. It's a place of fire. It's a place of utter damnation. It's a place where you don't get out of. It's an awful place, and I wouldn't want my worst enemy to go to hell. I wouldn't want my worst enemy, if I've got any tonight, to go to hell. I'd want everybody to be born again. I want everybody to be saved. And I would say, if you were right with the Lord tonight and you begin to think about hell and you begin to think about heaven, you'd say, Brother Clark, I want everybody to be saved too, because you don't want anybody to go to hell. But tonight we're going to deal with this man. Notice number one, I want to show you this man had credentials in his life. This young man, I like to think about him as a young man who maybe started at an early age and got started in an occupation, but he had a good mom and a good dad, and he had a good home, and he had a lot of good things going on, and he was raised with privilege in his life. He was a man of credentials. In other words, he was somebody in the community. He was somebody who had worked his way up. He had spent his life doing whatever he had to do to encourage his work and to encourage sales and do whatever, build whatever he was. Whatever his business was, he gave it his all, and it showed in his life. He had a lot of things because he worked hard. And let me say, he was a man of credentials. But this man found out after a conversation with Jesus Christ that it doesn't matter how many credentials you can hang on the wall. It doesn't matter who you are tonight. You still must be born again. I tell you, the most smartest man in the world with all the degrees in the world, he still must be born again. The Bible talks about, hey, it's good for those that have no money. It's good for those that are poor because they can get in on salvation. But let me tell you tonight, if you're lost and you got all the money in the world, you still need to be born again. I don't care what's a professor you can show me in a college somewhere who thinks he knows more about God than anybody else and thinks he knows more about the creation and all this stuff. I don't care who he is, he still has to be saved. He can have as much, he can have enough doctor's degrees to fill a thermometer. It doesn't matter to me. He still has to be saved. You see, this man was a young man of, he had credentials in his life. He was rich. If anybody deserved to buy heaven, this man could. But you find out that, it's not about money. You say, well, it goes contrary to what the world teaches. Right. They think if you don't have enough, the Catholics will teach you if you don't pay enough. If you don't prove that you've got enough, then and if you don't do this and give to the church and do all these things, though those things are good things, we're not. This has no weight when we're talking about going to heaven. So he was a man of credentials, but credentials don't get you to heaven. He was a man, notice, of character. Look in verse number 20, the Bible talks about, thou knowest the commandments. Jesus tells him, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not. In other words, don't step on somebody else to get ahead. He talks about, don't cheat your way to the top. He says, honor your father, honor your mother. And Jesus basically rattles off the Ten Commandments to him. He said, what was he talking? And this man, here's what he said. He answered and said unto him, Master, all these I've observed from my youth. If he was in the youth department, he would have been a perfect teenager. Man, that'd be something to see, wouldn't it? Amen. Buddy, he'd be, if he was in, I mean, if he was a church man, he'd be the best. I mean, he'd be the best singer, the best person. I mean, he'd have no problem. If, according to his testimony, he did no wrong. Now, I'll give you a couple areas of thought on this. Well, number one, he was either a really good young man. Amen. Or he was just a big liar. Because I've never met anybody who's never done any of those things. But to give him the benefit of the doubt tonight for sake of the message, we'll just say he was a good young man.
Right.
But he finds out that you can have all the character in the world, you can have all the good works in the world, you can do all the things right, you can dot every I and cross every T, but at the end of the day, none of that matters when we're talking about going to heaven. You see, he came to the Lord and asked him about eternal life, and he said, Lord, I've done all those things, but all those things had nothing to do with going to heaven. You say he was a man of character, and I'll tell you, I've met some good men in my life. I've met some good ladies in my life, and I'm talking about the kind of people that may not come to church, they may not this or that, but they've got good character. And I'll tell you, character is a scarce thing in the day we live in. We need a revival of character in our young people. We need a revival of character in our old people, where we say, hey, when they say they're going to do something, they ought to do it. You ought to keep your word. You ought to have character when nobody's looking to do right. Hey, you ought to have character today in this day and age when everything's dark and nobody can. You think nobody can see? Hey, we ought to have some character about us. But character don't get you to heaven. It's not about having character. Though we need it, it's not about that. It's not about his credentials. It's not about his character. He's a man of character. Number three, he was a man of commitment. So what do you mean? He was a very committed young man. I believe this kind of man was, if he was in our church, he wouldn't have been a good old boy. I'm talking about if your cars broke down in the parking lot, he'd give you a ride. If you're out of gas, he'd give you a ride to the store. He'd probably buy you gas for you. Well, you know, if times was tough and you needed something and all you had to do was ask this fella, and I tell you, he would have probably helped you out. He was a very committed young man. I believe the Bible talks about him obeying his father and mother, and he knew the law. He was a man, I believe he was a man who would have went to church. He was a man who knew the scripture. He was a man who did right. He was a very committed young man. But you can be the most committed individual in the church tonight and not go to heaven. You say, what do you mean, Brother Clark? I mean, you can come here every time the doors are open. You can be just like clockwork writing that tithe check. Or you can be just like clockwork coming on Saturday visitation. And you can be just like clockwork with everything you do in your life. And you be very committed. But being committed doesn't get you to heaven. You see, we notice all these things, but I want to show you some things tonight. I'm hurrying tonight. I want to show you a few things about the way this man came. See, this man was a good guy. He was a good young man. He was a good guy. He wasn't the maniac of Gadara. This man came to the Lord. I want to show you a few things about how he came. Notice verse 17. The Bible says, and when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? I want you to notice, number one, he came the right way. You see, this whole scripture is about salvation. Now, you could apply it in a lot of ways in your life. About one thing thou lackest in serving God, one thing you need to get out of your life as far as sin. You could apply it a lot of ways, but this message tonight is rooted in salvation. It's right here. He came to the Lord and he came running. In other words, there was a sense of urgency in his life. He knew he needed what Jesus had. Hey, I'll tell you, I'll take somebody who says, hey, I know what I need and I need Jesus. Hey, I've met a lot of people out visiting and out soul winning and meeting people here and there. They know what their need is, and they'll be honest with you. They'll tell you they know that there's something missing in their life. They know something's not right. They know they need something, and they're not arguing that they're with you about it being Jesus. He came the right way. The Bible says he came running. There was a sense of urgency in his life to get to God. I tell you, it would be nice tonight on the side to say that when we have problems in our life and things come up in our life, if we could just run to God, if we could just take from example from this young man, he knew he needed what God had. He knew he had to get to God, and he came running. He came with a sense of urgency. There was something about it. He said, you know what? Concerning salvation, concerning me going to heaven, I've got to get to Jesus. Hey, I'm going to tell you, tonight I got saved. Nobody else could help me. Nobody else's words could console me. I had to get to the Lord. And I had to get there quick. The Bible says he came running. And then notice the Bible says he came kneeling. He didn't come with a haughty spirit. He didn't come. Imagine this man. He's running. He's heard about the Lord being here. He runs and he kneels and says, good master. Probably out of breath. Probably just trying to get there. The Bible says he kneeled before God. I'll tell you, the Bible talks about God resisteth the proud, but he giveth grace to the humble. You say, what kind of person can God reach down and use? What kind of person can God touch? He can touch one that's humble. Humble before God, that says, God, it's not me. It's not anything I can do on my own. But Lord, I'm going to kneel before you and say, God, help me. I think about the man in Luke chapter number 9. Had the boy there. He got his boy. His boy was possessed with sickness and all this other. And he got to the Lord and he got before God. And he knew that God was the only one that could help him. Bible talks about he tried everything. The woman with the issue of blood tried all the great physicians. Hey, let me tell you something. The Lord wants to be your only choice. The Lord wants to be your only option. You say, well, when I can work it out, yeah, when you can work it out, you can get glory. But when you took God to the test and you get to a place in your life where only God can come through and you kneel before God humbly. See, notice he came running, he came kneeling. We're talking about the way he came. There's nothing wrong with the way this man came to Jesus. I've seen a lot of issues with how people come to Jesus. I've seen people just gallivanting down an aisle, just like, you know, nonchalant, very just whatever. Let me tell you something. That spirit ain't going to get much work done with the Lord. But you give me somebody who comes down and says, I ain't got nothing. I'm just going to kneel before God. I ain't got nothing to offer God. I'm just going to kneel. He came humbly and kneeled before God. And notice not only he came running, he came kneeling, but he came asking. A lot of people come demanding. I think about different ones in the Bible, and we give you example after example, but different ones that came demanding something out of Jesus. But this man didn't do that. This man came and he asked. Notice what he asked. He says, good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? So number one, he came the right way. Number two, he came to the right person. I tell you, hallelujah, he came to Jesus. You say, well, I just can't seem to get anything worked out in my life. I just can't seem to work it out. I've been trying it on my own. I've been trying everything I know to do, and it just ain't working out. Well, I just tell you something. Why don't you just go to Jesus? Hey, let me tell you something about Jesus. Jesus has never failed you one time. Jesus never has failed at anything he's ever tried to do. He never failed when it came to creation. He never failed when it came to salvation. He's not going to fail when he talks about coming back. He's coming back just like he said he was. And you mark it down. You say, well, I don't know. I haven't seen him. Hey, you don't have to see him to believe in him. Amen. I tell you that Jesus, he came to the right person. He called him good master. Hurriedly, I'll say number three, he came at the right time. You say, what do you mean? Look when he came. The Bible says when he was gone forth into the way. You say, what kind of way did he come? He came the way Jesus came. Right. He went a route that intersected him with Jesus. He went at the right time. You say, when do I do business with God? Hey, when he's doing business with you. Hey, when do I need to get saved? You can get saved right now. Hey, when the Spirit of God draws you, you can get saved. Hey, you say, when is God going to help me? Hey, when God is always right on time. I tell you over there with Lazarus, he said he was 4 days late, but I'm going to say, just like the song, he was right on time. He wasn't late. In our eyes, sometimes the Lord doesn't come through when we want him to, but Jesus is never late. He's never going to fail you. He's going to be right there with you every time you've ever needed him. Hey, Jesus is there. But he came at a time when Jesus was passing by. What if he would have thought, yeah, I need to get to the Lord and it's pretty urgent, but I'm going to wait. See, Jesus, he had 3.5 years of ministry. That's it. On this earth, he had 3.5 years to wander here, wander there, go here, go there, do miracles. Then he died on a cross. 33.5 years old, but 3 years of that was ministry. See, what if he would have said, I'm going to put that off? He didn't put it off. But how many times do we put it off? Lord, I'm going to try this my way one more week. Lord, I'm going to lay that down. I know that's right, but I'm going to do it one more time. Lord, I know that's yours, and I'm going to take this, and it's going to be my one more time, God. Or I'm going to get saved. I need to get saved, but I'm not going to get saved this week. Well, I know what's right, but see, this man, he came at the right way. He came the right person. He came at the right time. Number four, I'll show you, he came with the right question. He came with the right question. What did he ask the Lord? Notice what he asked him. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? I'll tell you, I believe he asked the most important question that could ever be asked. You say, what is the lost and dying world? What are they wondering about right now? They're wondering about afterlife. You talk to somebody who has no concept of church. Talk to somebody who has no concept of Jesus dying on the cross. You say, well, and you begin to talk to them about I guess they'd call it philosophical things and different things, how things happened and all. You begin just to open a conversation with people, and you will eventually get around to this. What happens when you die? One of the most beckoned questions that's ever been asked is, what happens when you leave this earth? And people will spend their life trying to research and trying to find out what happens when you die. That's people that are out, not even in church. But I wonder, do we not have people in church tonight wondering, man, I don't know. What happens when I take my last breath? What's it going to be like? You say, well, how do you know people think like that? Because I thought like that as a 13-year-old boy. I remember thinking, man, what's that going to be like? What's going to happen? But notice he came to Jesus and he asked the right question. He said, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He didn't come to the Lord. And think about it. He's got the Lord one-on-one. One-on-one, he's with the Lord. He's talking with God. He's got him. He's got all his full attention. Jesus is about to talk back to him. He's talking to the Lord. He's got full attention. Many people didn't even get that out of the Lord in those 3 years. But this man has him one-on-one. And here's what happens. He gets him hemmed over in the corner. He says, now, Jesus, I got to ask you this question. What happened to the dinosaurs? No, he didn't ask him that, did he? Well, Jesus, tell me about how that doctrine over there is wrong. Jesus, tell me about Moses. No. He said, tell me about eternal life. You say, what's the most important thing that I could share with my relatives? Eternal life. You say, well, they want to argue about everything else, what happened to the dinosaurs. What happened at the, how many, you know, this and that on the ark and all these questions. It ain't about the questions. It's about making sure you're born again. It's about making sure when you leave this earth that you know Jesus Christ. Because let me tell you, hell is too long to be wrong. It's not worth it. I tell you, I would take some time and make sure I'm saved tonight. And I'd make sure my family's saved. I'd make sure my relatives are saved and my coworkers are saved. You better make sure they're saved. I ain't got time to debate somebody where Dumbo is or whatever. I got time to talk about Jesus. Dumbo wasn't a dinosaur, he's an elephant. But you knew what I meant. You knew. But you see what I'm saying is he asked the right question. See, I don't have time to waste time on some of the, and we don't. We don't have, with the world, like people out there, they want to trip you up. They're not looking to help you, they're looking to hurt you. They're not looking to really get answers out of you about Jesus. Hey, if they don't have time to sit down and talk about the Lord, then I don't have time for that. I just don't. So I want to show you in verse 17. Then we're getting to the message, and I'll be shortly, and I'll be done. Verse 17. like preacher says. He talks about it being the introduction. Amen. So, but we see verse 17, we see a good picture. And what we've been preaching about this whole time is the sinner. This whole message is about salvation. We see the sinner in verse 17. You say, what do you mean? He's that man. He's that young man we're talking about. He came the right way, and there's nothing going on wrong with this man so far. He's now come to the Lord, and he's come honestly. He's come humbly. He's kneeling before God. He's concerned, and he's a sinner. You say, what happens? How do I know? How do I get saved? Number one, you got to be a sinner. How do I know? How am I going to find out if I'm going to heaven? Number one, you got to know you're a sinner. If you don't think you're a sinner, if you don't know you're a sinner, you're not getting saved. Jesus saves sinners. He loves everybody, but he saves sinners. Yeah. Jesus loves you no matter what you've done, no matter what you say about him, no matter what you do to him. Jesus loves you, but Jesus will save you if you become a sinner. So Jesus noted in verse 17, we see the sinner. In verse 19, we're talking about the plan of salvation here. We see in verse 19, we see the scripture. You say, what do you mean? Why does that have anything to do with salvation? Because you have to have the scripture to be born again. You say, well, Brother Clark, now wait a minute. I got saved and there wasn't no, I didn't read no tract. And nobody had an open Bible. Yeah, but there was still the scripture. There was still the Word of God that was placed in that soul winner's heart. There was still the Word of God that somehow penetrated your heart that began to, hey, we get truth from the Word of God. We get truth from the gospel and the Word of God. It's all about Jesus Christ. He said, I am the Word. Jesus is the Word. And you have to have the Scripture. So we see the sinner. Then we see verse 19, we see the Scripture. But in verse 21, we see the Savior. Nobody's getting saved if the Savior ain't on the scene. Well, I tell you, Brother Clark, I ran them through the plan of salvation, and I told them everything I need to tell them, and I tell you, yeah, that's good, you need to do that. But if the Savior's not drawing that man, if the Spirit of God is not working in that man's heart, then all you're doing is plowing a seed, and you need to do that. But you see, when you begin to do that, the Lord begins to work on his heart and begins to think, you know what, my grandmama way back when told me about this. You know, my stepdad just died, and I began to think a little about this. You don't know what that person's been going through. You say, well, he's just sharing the scripture. Yeah, but you don't know what they've gone through in their life. You have no idea. And you know what? And sometimes we do know. And sometimes that's why people at funerals are more softened to the things of God, because they're thinking about what happens after here. And they're thinking about lost loved ones, and they're thinking about loved ones that have gone on and different ones. But we see the Savior. And I want to show you a few things this evening about the Savior. Verse 21, we see Jesus, Bible says, Jesus beholding him, loved him, and said to him. Three things Jesus did. I want to show you, number one, Jesus beheld him. Now, if you're just reading that, it just looks like this. It's like Jesus looked down at him as he's talking to him. You think about it like that if you're reading it quick. But when you slow down and really read that, Jesus beheld him. Jesus looked at this man. And the Bible says he beheld him. The only way I know how to describe that, and beholding is more than just looking. Beholding, I think about when my son Hudson, many of you have seen him, he tears up nurseries everywhere he goes. He's horrible. No, and I'm just saying, he's not. You've heard about him. He's bad. No. But I think about the day he was born. And many of you parents will know exactly where I'm going with this. Beholding him. I remember my son was born, and I don't want to get too into it. I was preaching at a church a few weeks ago, and I got too detailed. And my wife told me, don't get too detailed with the birth story. And I said, yeah, you're right, amen. I said, she's going to win this battle. I'll give it to her. She's right, amen. And she had a recorder out. She heard me say it, so she can play it back. But I remember when my boy was born. And I remember, and many of you parents, again, you could tell this illustration better than I could probably, but I remember the first time the only time he was born, the doctor gave me Hudson. And then she was over there getting fixed up, gave me Hudson. And I'm standing there. Now, the first thing he did actually was they took him to the table. They took all tape on him, did all this stuff, got his nose, and then all this, did all this stuff to him, got his weight. You know how they do. Like a baby snatcher over there. I'm like, whoa, he's mine. And I put a permanent marker on his foot just to make sure they didn't swap him, amen. Then he looks like me, so I know they didn't swap him. God help. But I remember when they got him all fixed up, they handed him to me. Y'all know, parents remember this. And what do? You just sit there and you look. I didn't know what to say. Now, she's over there. My wife probably had the words for the moment. Wives always have the words for the moment. Men don't have the words. And I'm sitting there like, you know, just looking at him, kind of inspecting him, like, oh my goodness. And then it started setting in. He's mine. He started setting in about maybe his future. And that the Lord had trusted us with a baby. And that the Lord, now I'm not saying any of this, I'm just looking. You say, what does this have to do with the message? Jesus beheld him. Jesus looked at that man, and I believe he saw his future. I believe he saw him rejecting. He saw what's going to happen to him. He saw everything it had to do with this man. He saw it all. And he's sitting there and he's looking at him, knowing what he's about to do. The Bible says he beheld him, and then the Bible says Jesus loved him. Yeah. Aren't you glad Jesus loved you? Hey, I remember the day when you get saved, the first thing, Jesus, you know, hey, what does the beholding mean? Jesus saw him for who he was. Jesus saw him for who he was. Hey, I'm going to say, you don't come to God and impress God with anything you've got. Jesus looks down at you and he beholds you, but hey, Jesus still loves you. Jesus says, hey, I'll make a way for you, though you're wicked. He sees all the wrong you've ever done. He sees all the wrong you're ever going to do, but he sees a future in you. He sees somebody who will love him or who will reject him. Jesus beheld him, but Jesus loved him. And then, thank God, he said unto him. So we see Jesus saw him. Jesus loved him. But then Jesus spoke to him. I sure am glad Jesus spoke to me one day. I remember where I was at when Jesus spoke to my heart. I tell you, hey, how do you get, this is about salvation. How do you get saved? Jesus will speak to you. Brother James, do you remember where you were when Jesus called your name? Hey, I remember where I was. And you say, was it audible? No, I could hear it in my heart. I knew it was much clearer than that. I knew God was still in my heart. It was bigger than, it was louder than my dad's call. It was louder than anybody else's call. It was louder than anything else in my heart. And Jesus spoke to me. But I want to say we got a mighty Savior. We got a Savior who sees us for who we are, but he loves us anyway. He said in John 14:6, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Sir, you're not going to heaven unless you go by Jesus. Ma'am, you're not going to heaven. You'll never see the pearly gates. You'll never see the clear street of gold. You'll never see any of that unless you get saved. Hey, they say, well, my mama, she was a good old woman. Yeah, and I know all that. But let me say this. This man had good parents too, but it wasn't about that. You can have the best family in the world and it has no weight when it talks about going to heaven. You say, well, I'm living on mama's religion. Mama used to stand up in church and shout. Yeah, good. Maybe some of us ought to, but hey, that ain't getting you to heaven. Sir, I don't know. I don't believe anybody here would stand up and argue this, but I will say this. There's no other way to heaven but by Jesus. There's nowhere else. Hey, you say, well, that don't make sense. It doesn't have to make sense. Well, that don't sound fair. It don't have to be fair. It's the Word of God. Yep. You say, well, people at work, they just seem like they don't agree with that. I'm sorry they don't agree with it, but it doesn't change it. Right. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. In other words, he said, I'm the way. You can be saved. He said, I am the way to heaven. You can be saved. I am the truth. You can be sure. Yep. You can know that you're saved. You don't have to wander through this life wondering, am I saved? Am I lost? Did I lose my salvation today? And all, it's not, you can be sure. Yeah. Jesus said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. You can be satisfied. He is the life. Yeah. You say, well, I'm saved, but I just don't have fulfillment in my life. I'm just always grumpy. I know a few like that. I'm like that sometimes. But when I get to reminding myself, God is my everything. I may not have it all together here, but I got all that I need concerning Jesus. And when you begin to think about that, he said, you might have life and I have it more abundantly. You know, I don't understand Christians that walk around with frowny faces. I don't understand Christians that always complain. I don't understand Christians that always are so negative about every little thing. We're going to heaven. Amen. Heaven is our home. Does that mean the trip's going to be perfect? No, Jesus just promised smooth sailing. It didn't promise smooth sailing, but a safe landing. It ain't. You're not promised to have no problems in this life. But we know what this. We know the landing's going to be safe. We know we're going to heaven. We know where we're going. Hey, I tell you, he said you can be satisfied. And I'll say this. We saw the Scripture. We see the Savior. And what I want to show you in verse 21, a couple things here. It says, go thy way. He says, one thing thou lackest. He didn't lack a bunch of things, but he lacked one thing. So what do you mean? Jesus said, one thing thou lackest. Somebody won't go to heaven or go to hell based on a bunch of different things. They won't be in heaven one day because of one thing. It won't be because they didn't do right by your words. It won't be because they weren't faithful, though we want them to be faithful. It's not about being faithful necessarily to the house of God. We're talking about getting saved. Now, when we talk about serving the Lord, it does matter. But they're not. That's not why they're not there or that they're there. The people that are in heaven are washed by the blood of the Lamb. They are the redeemed. They are the ones, in other words, that said yes to Jesus. They are the ones that you say, well, that means they're perfect. Nope. They just said yes to Jesus. You say, well, I don't know. I mean, it seems like there ought to be more to it. Well, maybe seems like it. But as far as going to heaven, it's about trusting Jesus. One thing thou lackest. You say, well, hi, Brother Clark. See, he didn't tell him that. Jesus talked about works right there. He said, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Let's look back at it close. Because I had a young man when I was 16 years old that took me to the scripture, and he really messed with my head about it. He was a boy at school. He told me, he said, yeah, I believe in work salvation. I said, I don't believe that. I was bullheaded when I was 16. You think I'm bullheaded now? You ought to see me when I was 16 years old, saved. I wasn't even living right, but I'd tell people they were wrong. I mean, I was bad. But I'm going to tell you this. I knew what was right. I couldn't tell you why, but I knew it was right. You say, what do you mean? I was raised in a good church. I knew what to say. I knew the answers. You say, well, did you do right? No. But I knew that going to heaven by works wasn't right. Did I have Ephesians 2:8 and 9 memorized? No. But I knew it was wrong. And I'd tell people, and they'd begin to bring that up. I'd say, no, you're not right about that. It's by the blood of Jesus Christ. So y'all want to go smoke a cigarette after school or what? It didn't line up, but I'm telling you what, I knew enough about what was right. I was raised in a good church, had a good pastor. And let me tell you something, eventually you can't live on just everything your pastor says, but when you're a young Christian, you better. Because this world's out there to trip you up. You get saved in the first year, you run into a Jehovah's Witness that knows how to argue and tell me you don't have issues. I'm just telling you, it'll happen. A Mormon, they'll tell you, I mean, all kinds of things. This new liberal movement. Well, it ain't about what you do. It ain't about all, hey, you better be sound in the Word of God. But until you do, you better just ask your pastor the answers. Yeah. Amen? But you see, I want to show you some things. He told me, he said, hi, that shows you work. So I want you to look at it real close. Everybody look at it. It says, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Now, for the longest time, I didn't understand this. I argued with that boy, and I said, I just agree to disagree. But I went to my pastor, went to Brother Preston Moore, and I said, preacher, I said, I know this isn't right, but this boy was telling me this is showing me some kind of work and him being saved. He said, well, let's look at it. And we looked at it one afternoon, and he said, well, Clark, I know what the answer is to this, but you're going to go home, you're going to study a couple days, and I'm going to tell you when we come back. We're going to have a discussion about it. So over that course of study, it dawned on me. And this may have hit you the first day you got saved, but it hit me later. He says, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Jesus dealt with this man's sin. Jesus will have to deal with sin before you'll ever get saved. Jesus has to deal with your sin. What was this man's sin? This man's sin was his treasure, and it had his heart. It had everything in his life. His life was wrapped around things. It was wrapped around making money. It was wrapped around making a life for himself, having success and all these things. It was wrapped in his heart, and it had his heart. That was his sin. But Jesus told him, he said, you've got to get rid of that so that you can make room for me to come into your life. You see, he deals with his sin. Jesus will always deal with sin. And then notice he says, come. And he says, come. And what does that mean? Not only Jesus deals with this man's sin, but then he invites this man. Jesus is always inviting. Jesus is always saying, come. You say, well, he says, come. He has two commands, come and go. Come and go. Come to me, get what you need. Come to me and help. I'll help you. I'll do everything you need. And then I need you to go get them and bring them to me. Come and go. Jesus told this man as a lost man to come to Jesus. You say, what am I supposed to do with my life? Tell people to come to Jesus. Tell people to get saved. Encourage people to come to church and come to the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see he invites this man. And then he says, take up the cross. He references his salvation right there. He tells this man, he said, look, I'm going to deal with your sin because if you're going to be saved, you got to deal with your sin. Come to God as a sinner. Right. And then he says, come. Then he tells them to take up his cross. Now, I will admit to this, as I study this, Jesus has not died on the cross yet. We know that. But Jesus, and I wonder, he may have known exactly what Jesus was talking about here. He might have. But I don't know that he did. I don't know that he understood that. I believe in that day that may have been common terminology, he may have understood it. But if he did not understand it, I believe he, and when he says, follow me, I believe he knew exactly what he was talking about. But I'll say this in this room tonight. When Jesus says, take up your cross, we all know what he's talking about. We are without excuse tonight. We say, well, what does he mean? He says, take up your cross. In other words, hey, you got to die to yourself. It's not about you anymore. It's about crucifying the old flesh, crucifying you, and getting Christ in your life. You say, I need to change my life. Yeah, you need to get saved. You say, so he invites him, and he talks about salvation, and then he says, follow me. He talks about his direction after he's been saved. The Lord begins to direct. How do you get direction? You get in the Word of God. In other words, he says, follow me. Follow me. And what does he get out of following Jesus? He gets commandments that come to follow. He learns to follow Jesus. He learns the statutes. He learns the Word of God. He learns what God's plan is for his life. And you say, what do I need to do after I get saved? You follow Christ. You follow Christ. How do I do that? You're faithful to church. You're in the Word of God. You start a prayer life. You form a prayer life. You start praying for your enemies. You pray for your loved ones. You start having a relationship with God. So I see where we see a good picture of the Savior in verse 21. And lastly tonight, in closing, I'll say this. Verse 22, we see the sorrow. We see the sinner. We see the Scripture. We see the Savior. We're talking about this man. If you didn't know the end of the story, he's about to get saved. Jesus just told him how. But look at verse 22. And he was sad at the saying and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. This man walked away lost. This man walked away. He walked to the door of heaven, looked in, had the keys, was told it could be his, laid him down and walked off. Never to return again to the door. He walked away with full intentions. Maybe one day he thought, well, I'll do this at a later date. I'll do this later on at a more convenient time. I'll do this later on. But it was too late. I wonder tonight, who's standing at the door? The door's open. You've got the layout. You know how it works. You know how to be saved. You've come the right way. You've come to the right person. You've come the right time. Everything's right, but you walk away lost. I don't see a record in the Bible of where this man ever got saved. Well, Brother Clark, he might have. Yeah, maybe. But I do believe, since he's mentioned in Mark chapter 10, we would have heard something about it. We would have heard something. Man, I hope he did get saved, but there's no record of him being saved. You say, what's the big deal? Well, here's the big deal. He died lost. Well, what's that matter? He's in hell right now. He's in hell right now. And listen, he's in hell because, and he ain't got to be. He's in hell right now, and he didn't have to go. And let me tell you something. Everybody in hell is in there, and you got a memory in hell. There's a memory there because the rich man, he remembered everything. He remembered when he denied. He remembered every little bit. You say, when I get to hell, I'll just, when I die, no, it's a place where you can't die. You'll have, hey, you can't die in heaven, praise God, but you can't die in hell either. Hell is forever. And let me tell you, you beg for a drop of water. You beg for just a moment of relief. You beg for it, but God says, I gave you a moment. I gave you a time to repent. I gave you, and God was just with you. Today is the day of salvation. So I don't know, Brother Clark, maybe you get out of hell. And there's nothing in the Bible. Well, you do get out, Brother Barry, for a moment to stand before the great white throne judgment. To then the place you were at, and death and you and everything are violently cast into the lake of fire. And then the tears are wiped away, and then you're never thought of again. So what's so bad about hell? here's the bad news. There's a lot of bad things. But one bad thing that dawned on me is you are totally forgotten about. You say, what's the big deal? You know how it feels maybe when, have you ever been felt like somebody forgot about you? And how that kind of sinks in? Like, oh, they forgot. Ah, it stinks. They forgot. Or they, you know, forgot my birthday, and then they're like, surprise, a big birthday party. They didn't forget, but you know how it felt when you thought they did forget? How about really being forgotten about? How about nobody can, hey, your name, hey, in hell you don't have a name. In heaven you get a name. In hell you've got no name. Hell is eternal. Hell is for real. Hell is forever. And hell, hey, after that, nobody even cares about what's going on in hell no more. It's over. And you're there to burn. I hate that, but it's what the Bible teaches. But you don't have to go. This man, he walked away knowing how to go, knowing everything. And he said, no, what I've got is worth too much.
Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.